And so if you have a Bible, would you turn with me to Matthew chapter 5? We've been going through the Sermon on the Mount, the greatest sermon I think ever preached. And Jesus has given this sermon early in his ministry. And we still got two more chapters out of this one. We're making our way very slowly in the Sermon on the Mount. And we're sort of talking about this and looking at this. And we're also talking about this idea of the kingdom of God. Jesus came and he said, I have a new kingdom. And I am a new king. And so there are unique possibilities here now that Jesus has come. He is the king. And sometimes when you hear the kingdom of God, you think, that's out there. It's somewhere not here. It's an impractical thing. It's not what's happening here right now in my life. But Jesus is talking to us about the kingdom in very relevant ways to our lives today. He says the kingdom of God is that which breaks into human reality. It's not something that's out there, but it's something that is right here. So the kingdom is not yet. It's not here in its fullness. But it's already here in ways as God rules and reigns through his people, those that are followers of Jesus, Christians. And so this is what Jesus is doing with the Sermon on the Mount. And so as we go through this, we need to understand that he's talking to us about issues that we all wrestle with, okay? They are very pertinent issues, and they are things that take our affections, and they're things that dominate our thoughts. Now, as we go through these things, like I said, we're going to see all these different things that Jesus wants to teach us about. When we talked about Jesus saying, you have heard, but I tell you. He says this a bunch of times throughout this. Jesus is correcting the teaching on the Old Testament scriptures, right? He's telling you what he's interpreting to us the way we are supposed to understand it. And so, as we go through this, that's what we need to understand. And so these are things that dominate our minds and our ideas and our thoughts. And is there anything, any other issue, I think, than this one that we're going to look at this morning that dominates our thoughts, which is lust? I don't think there's anything else more, sometimes. And I think lust is the issue that for many of us, if not all of us, we deal with. Yes, I understand that we all deal with anger. We talked about that last week, and that's very important for us to look at. But I think this one may be just as important. It may be just a bigger deal for us. And so Jesus is talking to us about the mind and what goes on in our heads. He's not just talking about what we do with our bodies here. He's talking about what's happening in our minds. And the issue of lust in the mind, I think, is something that we all struggle with. And so Jesus is telling us here the difference between what is true sex and what is false sex. And we go one way or the other with this, okay? Because the problem is that sex is a good thing. Now that's not a problem. That's not the problem right there. The problem is we're deceived by that. Because you can go, like I said, one way or another with this. You can say, well, sex is a bad thing, and that's what the church has done, I think, for a lot of years, and so only do it if you have to, only do it if you're going to have children. And then the other side of that is, well, sex is good no matter what. And so we're going to find the balance of that. Those are the extremes. We want to know what Jesus is teaching here in all this, and we want to find that middle lane. So the other thing I meant to tell you about is we're still trying to find the right clicker for us so I can don't have to tell Matt and turn to the next one. So Matt and I were talking this week. Maybe I'm going to give him a salute and we'll go to the next slide so you know we're going next time. I'll salute Matt this morning, okay? And we'll have some fun with it until ours comes in the mail. But Don Carson, he teaches, he says, this is what he says, sex is about timing and content. The world says in time and place, God says my time, my place. So Jesus is further arguing that what lust does is it damages the human soul in similar ways as to what adultery does. And I know some people that are just, you're thinking, well, that's just the most has already committed adultery with her in his heart. So this morning, I just want to give us some context of what Jesus is talking about, what these words really mean as Jesus is teaching. And so, I don't think there's much confusion with adultery, but let's define that this morning. And so adultery is sexual intercourse between a spouse and another person who is not their spouse. Okay? Then there's fornication. That's sexual activity between two unmarried people. And then what we have Jesus' really, he's really talking about here is sexual immorality, which is the word he uses in verse 28. And that's any sexual contact outside of a marriage covenant. Okay? And it's a Greek word, and that word is porneia. And it's this junk drawer word or term meaning any sexual activity outside of the marriage covenant. It's contact with a person, contact with yourself. That is what sexual immorality is. And so Jesus, what he is doing in teaching this is he's taking us deeper. He's saying we need to understand the sin underneath the sin. Okay? So we talked about last week with anger. We understand the sin underneath what's causing the anger. So we need to understand the motive and not just the act that happens. And so he's talking to us about that. And have you ever read this passage here of Jesus, what we've just read here, and we've just read it now, so yes, you've just read it, right? And you're thinking, how am I supposed to do that? What is Jesus talking about here? This seems way too difficult. Well, here's what lust seems to do, this is why it's so difficult for us, is that one, we're just deceived by it. We don't get it. Because one lie that can start adultery is, I am attracted to this person because of what's wrong with my spouse. When in reality, you are attracted to this other person, not because of what's wrong with your spouse, but because of what is wrong with you. That's the issue. And so we get deceived by that. And so we want to blame our culture, we want to blame our world, we want to blame that girl and what she was wearing that day. In reality, it's not those things, it's us. And we are deceived because we're people so dominated by lust. We just are. It's in us. And I'm not sure a culture maybe ever has been dominated by lust as much as ours has. I don't know if you've ever heard of Covenant Eyes, but Covenant Eyes is this program that you can put on your computer, your tablet, your phone, and it will help block that pornography, and it will help you stay accountable to with someone so that you can stay free from that in your life and stay pure. And they've also done a whole bunch of research when it comes to these kind of things. And so, you know, pornography is really just a public outing of lust. And so we know that our world has a problem, and we start looking at these statistics that Covenant Eyes have brought up, like, oh, it's really a problem. And so what they found is that 35% of internet downloads are related to pornography. That's everything, like business transactions, everything that's happening, 35% of it is to that. They say 9 out of 10 boys are exposed to pornography before the age of 18. 85% of young men and almost 50% of young women say that watching porn is at least a monthly activity. In fact, I just got an email from them this week, and they said the actual growing statistic is women. More and more women. They say 67% of young men and 49% of young women say that viewing porn is an acceptable way to express sexuality. So here's what's happening. People are now using porn to enhance their sex lives, so they think. So lust is mainstream. Lust is said that it's all good in our culture. Well, let me just tell you here, lust and pornography are the exact opposite of God's design for all of this. And all of those things, you know, they're about you, right? With lust and pornography, it's just about you. You don't even need another person. And Jesus tells us, knowing where even things would be today, he's preaching this, he knows what's going to be like today. He knows the gripping, addicting power of lust, and Jesus is here telling us how we can deal with lust. So we go to verse 29. And if you're, it said Jesus, so the research on adultery that happens through social media, things like Facebook and things like that, is actually astounding. People say, I am tempted every time I look at this person's profile, or what they're doing, and all these things. And if that's the case, maybe you should unfriend them. Like, be drastic with this thing. Cut it off, is what Jesus is saying. Get off Facebook. Be specific. What Jesus is really saying here is you have to take, you know, big measures and be very drastic with this. Deal with it specifically. Deal with it drastically. Do whatever you have to do. Find the source of it and cut it off. Deal with it. And maybe you just can't go to happy hour at your job, or you can't stay too long there, because if you're going to participate in our culture, you have to be in places that sometimes are a little edgy. And you can go to these things, and it starts getting a little bit too crazy, and that's your chance to get out of it. But you have to be drastic with this. You can say, well, I just won't go to those things then. Well, if you do that, you're not going to have any non-Christian friends. But you have to be very drastic when it's too crazy. Do whatever you can to deal with the growing lust that's in your heart. And so, sex and lust operate out of a specific philosophy. Either way, whether it's true sex or false sex, you can't just switch partners. You actually have to change or alter your mind. And this is very difficult when it's already been programmed. All the times in our culture and all the times that we have disobeyed God with lust and sexual sin, it's just in our heart. It stays there. So we go, you know, the next one there, sex is good, but God says, as we've seen already, my time, my place for sex is marriage. So as we understand the Bible teaches that marriage is one man, one woman for one lifetime. That's the true context, or context of marriage that we see in the Bible. The Bible talks about this marriage covenant. And we use words with marriage like alliance, or a pact, or an agreement. And marriage is all of those things, but it's a whole lot more than that. In fact, next week we're going to talk about marriage, singleness, and divorce. We're going to get into that a little bit more. But in the ancient Near East, when it talks about covenant, they would make these covenants with one another. What they would do is they would take an innocent animal, and they would kill that animal, and they'd cut it into pieces. And they'd put those pieces to the sides of the two people making the covenant. And the two parties who were making it would stand on each side of these pieces, and they would walk in between the pieces. And once they got into the middle of those, they would look at each other. And each of them would say, if I violate my terms of this covenant, may what happened to this animal happen to me. That was the seriousness of the covenant relationship at this time. And that's the context by which God designed marriage. And so when you think about marriage, it's a lot more different than the way that our culture, our world thinks about marriage and love. Covenant says we relate to each other based on our prior commitment, not our present performance. And so we're bound by vows, not comfort. We're connected by something more than just our own need. That's covenant relationship. That's the way we do relationships now, or the way that we do relationships now, and the way that mainstream is in those relationships is not really covenant relationships, but it's more of a consumer relationship thing. And consumer relationships say, I relate to you based on performance. And so if you are performing, then I will stay in that relationship with you. That's the way we do commerce, right? Think about it as capitalism. We bring our capitalism into our marriages. We're connected because you benefit me. And then consumers say, you're the next one over there. That's the only one. Thanks. What have you done for me lately? A covenanter, somebody in a covenant relationship, says, what did I promise you previously? And so for a consumer, it's all about if you're not performing, I'm out of this situation, I'm out of this relationship. Covenant says we made a promise, we shared some vows, and so I am going to be here. I am part of this. And so the context is, or this context in the covenant relationship, that is where sex belongs according to the Bible, in that covenant marriage relationship. And this gets You don't have to really spin your image anymore. You can just be yourself. And that might be a knock on marriage for a lot of people. I don't know. But that's the way we believe marriage. And you may say, well, you're talking about marriage where I deny myself and I prefer the other. That's where I'm not as worried about my needs as much, but I'm worried about the other's needs. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. And I might get into this deeper and more, but good marriages happen when partners say, I am preferring you first. And it's so counterintuitive. It really is. Too many people think that I have to get what's mine. I have to find and get, just get mine so I'm good. I have to figure this all out for myself. I can't trust anybody else but me, so I have to be first. Let me tell you something. When you become a parent, that gets thrown out the window right away, okay? It does. Because that's just not how parenting works. And if you don't have any kids, let me just help you understand the pain that you're going to be involved with when you do, okay? But it does. It hurts really good, okay? So what's going to happen is your kids are going to break your heart almost every day. Sometimes they aren't going to reciprocate your love. They won't express their gratitude for all the sacrifices that you made. Sometimes they're going to disappoint you on every single level, yet you're going to keep on loving them and sacrificing for them and serving them. And the strange thing that happens is, as they're ungrateful at times and as they're unresponsive and sometimes even ungodly, you just love them. Apart from everything We must not pursue the kind of sex that avoids commitment and intimacy, leaving us more lonely than ever, the kind of sex that can never become one. In sexual sin, we violate the sacredness of our own bodies, these bodies that were made for God-given and God-modeled love, becoming one with one another. So what this is really saying is sex is whole life oneness, it's connectedness. There's a Christian psychologist named John White, and he wrote this book called Eros Defile. And he said, he said, the bodily exposure that arouses and accompanies sex can be profoundly symbolic and powerfully healing if it is a concrete sign of what is happening in the whole relationship. So it only makes sense that sexual relationships can be confined to marriage, one man, one woman, for one lifetime, for mutual disclosure and tender acceptance is not the activity of just a moment, but the fabric of a lifetime's weaving. And so it's supposed to be a unifier in a marriage covenant. It's supposed to be a connector. It's supposed to be a commitment builder. But if it's used wrongly, even with lust in our minds, it actually disconnects you. It separates oneness. It causes a split in our emotional equilibrium. And that's why Jesus brings in this metaphor here of hell. You saw that. He says, better than to cut off your hand or gouge out your eye, right, than your whole body be thrown into hell. Well, the word that he uses for hell here is the word Gehenna. And you have to understand the Bible talks about hell differently. The Bible talks about hell in just different ways. And here's the metaphor that Jesus is using with this. Gehenna was kind of like this landfill in their time. And in Gehenna, the fire never went out. Things that were there were really hot, but they were not consumed by the fire. They were disintegrating, and it wasn't just because of the fire, but it was because of the elements that were there. And so we read this and think, oh man, if I lust, I'm in hell. Why don't we go to the next one here? Jesus used this good metaphor to say that what it does, what lust does to you, is like it's hellish to you. It's disintegrating you. It's hell because it isolates you. There's this unquenchable thirst in you. There's this unsatisfied longing. That is what happens. And when we have these thoughts that come into our heads and our minds, what happens is it splits us apart. It makes us insecure. It makes us ashamed. But Ephesians chapter 5 says that the relationship between Jesus Christ and the church and the relationship between a husband and a wife are very similar. And so when marriage is done right, sex in its proper context actually is a picture of heaven. So when my wife Ann and I are connected, we are one. I'm not just talking about physically only here, I'm talking about in every single way. When we are one, there's actually nothing better than that. It's incredible. There's nothing like it. And so I want to give us some hope right now with all of this. This isn't always the funnest thing to talk about, especially at church, right? But this is things that Jesus talks about, so it's important for us to take a look at.
Amen.
I'm going to give us some hope here. How does God change me from this? Well, this week, if I have your email, I'm going to send out some resources that you can get to help you battle lust in your life. If you don't get our emails and would like to, make sure you write it down to me before you leave here this morning. But I want to give you some more resources because we're not going to go real deep into this, but I want you to have those in your life. But I want you to realize that Jesus so that you could to live the way God has called you to, and He's given you that freedom. And this new affection was given to you only